Assalaamu Alaikum. We carry on with where we left. To further reaffirm and establish themselves as an authority, our sheikhs invented another hadith narrative, even more dangerous, because it helps establish the halal and the haram authority beyond what it already was. They say in the hadith, and this hadith is authentic, reported by Abu Dawood, At-Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Ahmad, who is the teacher of Bukhari and Muslim. And remember, Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Ahmad, Nasai, all these people were at the same time as Bukhari and Muslim, and they were learning from each other, so they were a community. And even this hadith is authenticated and classified as authentic by Al-Albani. Remember, when they say authentic, they talk about the chain of narrators, not about the content. But since they agreed that the people who reported what is going to be reported is are authentic, it means what they say is also true. I'm going to just go to the English translation, and they say, indeed, the superiority of a scholar over a worshipper is like the superiority of the moon above all other heavenly bodies. See, back then in time, the moon is the closest to us, so we see big, especially when it's full and lit and beautifully white and all that kind of stuff. But all the other heavenly bodies, they are very far. So to them, they say the scholar is like the moon, right in your face, shining beautiful and all that kind of stuff. And the rest of the Muslim populace is like all the other heavenly bodies out there. That's if there is a patronizing racism, is this kind of hadith. But anyhow, and then it says, إِنَّ الْعُلَمَاءُ هُمْ وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءُ. Surely the scholars are the inheritors of prophets, that are the heirs. People do not leave behind, the prophets do not leave behind a dinar or a dinar. They don't leave behind monetary currencies, wealth. But rather they leave behind knowledge. So, whoever takes from it, i.e. from the knowledge, has indeed taken a great share of that inheritance left by the prophets. See, you see the danger? Now, the scholars are directly linked with prophets. So, when a scholar talks, it is as if a prophet has spoken. And we Muslims, so when the Sheikh speaks, it is as if the Messenger of Allah had spoken. To further highlight the dangers of this narrative that I'm talking about now, listen to what is written in one of the most prominent Islamic sites, and this one is called Islam Way. Islam Way, at one point in my life, I used to be the person who would answer questions of people in the English. I was the manager of the emails and questions and things like that, and just a side note. But anyhow, in Islam Way, they wrote an article about the status of scholars in Islam. And they mentioned the narrative that I just mentioned, that the scholars are the inheritors, the heirs of the prophets. And then they said the following. Scholars have a great merit. People need them all time, at all times. And they do not need people. So people need the scholars, but the scholars do not need people. And to keep people, that's the end of their speech. Now, to keep the people under the spell and control, these people need to be scared. So, what they say? Again, they concocted another hadith narrative. This one, it reads that Allah does not take away knowledge by snatching it from the chest of people, from the heart, from the minds of people. Rather, how knowledge gets away from people, it's when Allah takes the scholars who hold the knowledge. And when the old scholars are died, it means the knowledge has gone, people will turn to ignorant heads, ignorant people. And when they are, the ignorant people, when they are asked, they will give wrong religious answers without knowledge. And with that, with those wrong answers, they lead the people astray and they lead themselves astray. And this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. So to stop people from holding these men of religion and the religious institution behind them responsible, or to challenge their understandings or judgment or what they say, they tell you the flesh of the scholars is poisonous. This is not a statement made by the messenger, but is by Ibn Asakir, someone who died somewhere in the 6th century. In brief, this is how the men of religion are presented to the masses in the Islam way. And of course, they took it from other books. And this is the consensus on what the people agree upon, the scholars, of course. They say, the scholars are the masters of the people. And they are the revered leaders. They are the beacons of the earth, because they are the guiding light. And the inheritors of the prophets. They are the best of people. Through them, good is meant for the people, and are the ones whom forgiveness must be sought for. As you can see, that's it. We are in the hand of the scholars. But the problem is, they further say, this Islam way and the other books, they say there is no difference between a prophet and a scholar except in the prophethood, i.e. in the river, that Allah has revealed to one, the prophet, but didn't reveal to the scholar. But you know what the danger is? Actually, the prophet and scholars are not the same. Scholars are better than prophets. Here is why. If Allah has revealed to a prophet a knowledge, but the scholar reached the knowledge by himself, and the prophet has the advantage of being revealed too, but the scholar wasn't given that privilege, who is better than the other one? It's the scholar. Let me give you another example. If you have two students, one of them goes to school, the other one doesn't go to school, and then both of them have an exam. The pupil or the student that goes to school gets A mark, mark A. And the other one, who never went to school, gets an A mark. Who is better than the other one? It's not the one who went to school. It's the one who didn't go to school and got an equal mark to the one who went to school. So if the scholars could get the knowledge as equal to the prophets, but the only difference between them two is that the prophets were prophets of Allah and the scholars weren't, then the scholars are better than the prophets. And that's why our scholars become, as they call them, the untouchables. They are the untouchables, men of religion. This halal and haram and the in-between hadith narrative, along with the scholars being the inheritors of the prophet, and that the religious knowledge is closed. It's closely tied to the life of the scholars, not the Quran, but humans. You see, in all this, the Quran doesn't get mentioned at all. All right, it places the men of the religion as at a high and above any reach of any human out there. In fact, the religious institution and the scholars, members of these places, have gained the same power as the Catholic Church in the Middle Ages gave that power to the Pope and the Archbishops and all these people. You see, what happened in Europe from the year 500 to 1500 Christian era, already, so that is around 600 years ago. Denominations didn't exist at all back then. There was only one denomination, and that was the Roman Catholic Church. Back then, there was that. The Orthodox, the Presbyterians, the other, they didn't exist. The Catholic Church was the predominant. It was the top of everything. This church, the Catholic Church, was very powerful, extremely powerful. So much so that if a king, let's say the king of France, didn't have the blessings of the Pope, the people wouldn't listen to the king. They wouldn't. That's why there was no Baptist church, no Methodist, no Presbyterian church, nothing of this kind of church today. There was only one, the Catholic one. And things remained like that until another priest called Martin Luther. He was a German professor of theology. And as you know, theology is the study of God and religious beliefs and everything. And with his coming, when he came, he pushed for reforms to take place in the Catholic Church. After he himself became a priest in the year 1507, He started rejecting several teachings and practices of the Roman Catholic Church itself. Well, long story short, after Martin Luther, Christianity was never the same. And slowly, 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 the power of the church started waning. Waning as in going, weakening and going away. Of the first things he did, i.e. Martin Luther, was to translate the Bible from Latin to German. And by doing this, he took the authority of the church over the Bible. Because, you see, back then, the Catholic Church was the only one who could read the Latin Bible. Everyone else couldn't. And the church made sure people didn't learn Latin. So when Martin Luther came, he changed that. He translated the Bible from Latin to German. And suddenly, it became something that people could have, could buy. People could read the Bible for themselves now. The church didn't have that absolute authority no more. This practice has been and is still mimicked by the Islamic church today. You see, our church or the Islamic institutions or our sheikhs and even, though you can read the Quran yourself, but you cannot and you are not entitled and you don't have the right to understand what Allah says. What you understand must always be double-checked by a sheikh. Even though Allah in the Quran says that he made the Quran easy and for people to comprehend and derive the rulings, what Allah tells them, the sheikh tell you, no, you cannot do that. We are exactly at the same level as the people were when they were dealing with the church. Just like the priests, the bishops, the archbishops, the cardinals and the pope all were untouchable in the church, so our sheikhs and scholars and the mufti and the high council scholars, they all are untouchable. If I, Abdussalam, today say Ibn Baz was wrong, Al-Albani was wrong, Ibn Uthaymin was wrong, or Ibn Taymiyyah was wrong, I am looked at, thought of and considered to be a crazy, stupid who is deviated. That is the power of brainwashing people into submission. This hadith narrative ensures that the sheikh and scholars are given ultimate and full power in Allah's Islam. The whole purpose of this halal and haram and in-betweens, of this malicious, as I call it, narrative, is to put the men of religion on the highest pedestal, to make them the religious untouchables. What they say must pass. These untouchables, men of religion, did cash on this opportunity. And this is how they managed to mess up and complicate Allah's Islam beyond recognition. The only thing that helped them achieve divine stardom was and still is the hadith narratives, i.e. the sunnah. This is why they get into fierce feud with anyone who speaks against the hadith. If I get this a lot, I tell people openly, I don't believe in any hadith. They go, what? No hadith? No. I say, no, no hadith. I don't believe in them. I don't accept them. But I said, there is no but. There is only the Quran for me. Mention something to me with the Quran and I am here. If you mention the hadith to me, I'm Ira here. People cannot get their heads around this and they find it difficult. And for something such thing that is obvious, but to them, hey. But anyhow, what do the people, the minority, have that the majority doesn't have? What do they know that the majority cannot know? Because this question must be asked. What do these men of religion, the scholars and the sheikh, need to know that is unclear? See, those things that fall between the halal and the haram, or are mixed with the halal and haram at the same time. How can they get to them? And the man of religion answered, and what they said will help us understand how those things that are unclear can be resolved. Well, they say, first of all, you must know very well the Quran. All right, my hat is off to you. Quran, yes. Then they add to that, and you also must know the Qudsi, the sacred hadith. Oh, okay. And then you must have a good knowledge of the hadith itself. So I need the Quran, the Qudsi hadith, and the hadith to be able to figure out those unclear things. They go, yeah, you need those. But let me, before I move forward, let me introduce to you the Quran and the Qudsi hadith and the hadith and what they mean by those things. You see, because the Quran, what the Quran means to them and what the Quran means to you is completely different things. You see, the words and the expressions, when they say the Quran, okay, and we go, what is the Quran? They say, oh, the Quran is the word of Allah. Okay, they mean the words and expressions are from Allah. The words, i.e. what Allah says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, these words are from Allah. The expression, what Allah has chosen to say, comes from Allah. He chose it by himself. Nobody influenced the choice of Allah to use the word. You see, you can say, I'm sorry, that you said I'm sorry, but your choice of using the I'm sorry is your own. Nobody told you. You could have said, oh, please pardon me, whatever it is, but anyhow, not even the Holy Spirit, Jibreel, not Muhammad, not any other messenger. So the Quran is only from Allah. For example, Allah says in the Quran, Kitabun anzalnahu ilayk, a scripture or a compilation of law. Ah, by the way, the word kitab, which oftentimes is translated into book in English, it doesn't mean the book that you buy from a library and you read, or the book as is today. The book, the word kitab is a Hebrew word that means the law. So when Allah says ذَلِكَ الْكِتَاب, when Allah revealed, for example, the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, and he says ذَلِكَ الْكِتَاب, that book, but when the Surah Al-Baqarah was revealed, the book was not complete. But what Allah means is that law, that scripture that contains the law. And this is, whenever you hear book, it's the compilation, it's the scripture, it's the gathering of Allah's laws in one particular place. That's what the book is. But anyhow, Kitabun anzalnahu ilayk, a scripture or that contains the laws that we have sent down to you, Ya Muhammad. Mubarakun, i.e. blessed with a lot of good in itself, and blessed for those who follow the message. Okay. So that's what Allah says about the book. Okay. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ, so that they ponder or reflect or study the content, the ayat of the Quran. وَلْيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ, and let those people who have reason or have more knowledge and can study more keep this reality in their mind, that the Quran is for every single person to ponder and reflect on. Now the question is, this ayah, which is from Surah Sa'd, the surah number 38 and the ayah is 29, was revealed in Mecca in the early days of Islam. So from the get-go, from the beginning of Islam, Allah is saying that the Quran was descended upon Muhammad, and that this Quran is blessed in itself because it has a lot of good that it offers for the people to interact with it, to ponder over it. So Muhammad was just to deliver the Quran to the people of Mecca and leave them with their understandings. It never was the job of Muhammad as a messenger to explain to people what Allah says. Allah doesn't need anyone to explain what he means and what he wants to say. But people, the sheikhs, our sheikhs, they said, no, stop. You need to know few things. You need to know full Arabic, and you need to know this, and you need to know that, and you need to know this, and to be able to comprehend the Quran. You go, really? So Allah's just, but anyhow, so that's what they said. Then they jump to the point number two, the Qudsi Hadith. And this is, you're going to scratch your head. The Qudsi or the sacred hadith, they define it like it's a revelation from Allah sent down to the messenger. Okay? Now, here is the difference between the sacred hadith and the Quran. They say, whereby the meaning is from Allah, but the wordings is left to the messenger to choose the word. La ilaha illallah. This is crazy. How come Allah just gives the meaning and then leaves the messenger? Why did Allah stop doing that? Why didn't Allah provide the meanings and the wordings, like the Quran? Why did he just produce the meaning and then the messenger was left to choose the words? In other words, the Qudsi or the sacred hadith is a 50-50 cooperation between Allah and Muhammad. Allah gives the meaning, Muhammad gives the wordings. And this is crazy and absolute false and goes against the spirit of Islam, that Islam belongs to Allah and Allah alone. Inna dina inda Allah al-Islam. Certainly and indeed, the religion, the only way that Allah accepts with Allah is Islam. You see, the man of religion said that Allah gave the messenger the meaning of what he meant. And they say, so that the messenger clears himself from the sacred hadith, he starts whatever he's going to say by Allah says. That's it. When he says Allah says, so when he's in Mecca preaching to the people of Mecca, the disbelievers, when he wants to transmit to them what Allah has given him the meaning and he's saying the wordings, all he has to do is Allah says, and the people, the kuffar of Mecca, the people who don't believe in Mecca, the Quraysh people, straight away would understand, oh, this is not from Muhammad, this is just the meaning from Allah, the wordings are from Muhammad. What a joke. This is an absolute lie. Because Allah didn't say, he just gave the general idea to Muhammad and Muhammad was left to compose the words. It never happened like that. But that is what is sold to us, and this is what we are supposed to believe and accept. And if you don't do, then you cannot be a true believer. Why? Because our Sheikh says so, not the Quran. And now we come to the hadith. They say that both the meanings and the words come from the messenger of Allah. To believe that both the meaning and the words come from the messenger of Allah. If then both the meanings and the words come from the messenger of Allah, why do we say it's a revelation? Why do we say that the hadith is a revelation? Both of them come from a human being. If the meanings and the words are from the messenger himself, the human being, then why is it considered a revelation? How and where is this revelation come? What is it? You see, after this long introduction, and it's needed because I just don't want to say a couple of words and that's it. I give you the whole thing. Remember, I'm telling you the other side of the story. I am the menu at the fancy restaurant, and the menu of fancy restaurant has the title of the dish, the ingredients of the dish, and the price of the dish, the picture of the dish. You get so that you get a good idea about what you are going to order, because once you ordered it, it is yours. Already? So let's go back now to the sinister and dangerous hadith narrative itself of the halal and the haram and in-betweens. I am going just to mention the translation because to save on time, but here is how it goes. On the authority of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir. An-Nu'man ibn Bashir is the name of the person who transmitted the hadith. He says that I heard the messenger of Allah say, one person, and for your information, this hadith is transmitted only from An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, no other. It's him. He is the source of this hadith. If this man had kept his mouth shut, we would never ever have heard of this hadith. Of course, you will see later on that he is innocent of all this, but anyhow. He says that the messenger of Allah said, the halal is clear, and the haram is clear. So both of them are clear. You cannot mistake them. Okay. But between them are confusing matters that a lot of people do not know. Okay. So whoever avoid these shubuhat. You see, Bukhari and Muslim use two different words for the same meaning, so to speak. One of them says shubuhat. So whoever avoids this shubuhat, i.e. confusing matters, has indeed cleared his religion and honor up. His religion and the honor. And what I mean by this is that he has kept the religion and his honor cleared, clean and safe. But whoever falls in this shubuhat, the confusing matter, i.e. whoever indulges in them, has fallen in the haram. Okay. I wanted to pay, but your brain is going to hurt a little bit, but it's needed. If one indulges in those confusing matters, find themselves in haram. This means those things are already haram because it is impossible to do something that is halal and find yourself in haram and vice versa. One cannot lie to speak the truth. Just as one cannot tell the truth and lie. It is impossible. You cannot eat halal meat yet get sin for doing that. This is the idea of doing the shubuha, the confusing matter, which by their nature are unknown. If the confusing matters by their nature are unknown, how come when someone does them, they find themselves in haram? How? See, I don't know. We're going to take an example. Yeah? Water is halal. All right. Drinking wine is haram. All right. So these are two well-defined. If I mixed water with wine, if they get mixed, are they halal or are they haram? The sheikhs tell you, oh, this is a confusing matter. Is it? But the truth of the matter, it's not confusing at all. Because when Allah prohibited the drinking, He prohibited it for a reason. Is that you cannot use the faculties and the abilities of your mind, of the brain. If you drink a drink and it doesn't get you drunk, then it is not haram. Just like vinegar. Vinegar at one point in its existence was wine. But later on it became vinegar. If you are one of those strange people who can drink vinegar, go ahead, drink a whole barrel. But it's not going to get you drunk. Even though vinegar at one point in its existence was wine. It was fermentation and all that kind of stuff. So now, but the sheikhs will tell you, oh, stop. If you mix water with wine, that's a dangerous matter. And if you drink it, you're going to find yourself in haram. Why? Why do I have to find myself in haram? Why can't I find myself in halal? Of course, if you mixed wine with water, whichever takes the top, the ruling will follow. For example, if the water has taken the top and you drink that drink and you don't get drunk, hey, go ahead, drink it. But if the water and the wine get mixed and if you drink it, you get drunk, don't drink it. Allah has explained this in the Quran, but the sheikh make it seem as a confusion to think. Another thing, for example, yeah, they tell you if when you wipe over your socks, when you perform your wudu and you wear your socks or your boots or whatever, and then you wipe over them, no big problem. That's clear. So if you have your boots on and you have performed your wudu before, go ahead. And if you haven't, then don't do it. What if on the way to wearing my socks, just I put one foot in, and guess what? As I am going to put my second foot in, I fart. And as such, I break my wudu. So now, I have an issue. Is my wudu valid or invalid? Which one do I go with? And then the sheikh said, oh, that is a confusing matter. When in fact, it is not. Because when we go to the Quran, Allah talks about the outcome, not your state. I don't want to get into details about this, but I'm just giving you ideas of what the sheikhs say that is confusing and why. To them, they need to have knowledge and that makes them superior than you and whatever it is. Let's carry on. Then they say, then it is like, and then now they say that the messenger gave this example to illustrate the idea. It is like a shepherd who herds his sheep too close to a preserved sanctuary. So there is, you can take your sheep in an open field, have them, but there is a protected part that you cannot take your animals there. But they say now, if a shepherd takes his animals close to that sanctuary and he lets them graze there, okay, at one point one of the animals is going to jump inside and eat from it. In other words, now the confusing matter, they can lead to haram. So they say if you indulge in them, ultimately they're gonna take you to the haram. And that's why he says, every king has some forbidden boundaries. And the forbidden boundaries of Allah are what he has made haram. Okay? If these are the forbidden boundaries of Allah, why is there repentance then? Why? If Allah himself says, okay, let's go with their thinking of the forbidden boundaries, but Allah says, okay, if you find yourself inside the forbidden boundaries, just jump out, repent to Allah, I will forgive. Nothing has happened, move on. Why do they make big fuss of it? Why? But that is because the hadith is not meant for the halal and the haram. It was meant to control, to give an upper hand to the man of religion. That's the reason why. And they have already injected in you that you are stupid, you are dumb, you cannot think for yourself. And that's why when it comes to Islam, you become like a stupid cow out there who can only be led. You cannot think for yourself. That's the reason why Muslims today, we are in the state that we are in, because we have been deprived from the faculty that Allah has given us to think. After all, Adam, when Allah introduced Adam to the angels, when Allah wanted to show the angels that Adam had a different status than them, how did he do that? Didn't Allah teach Adam and then he told Adam, now tell the angels the names of these things? And when Adam told them, only then the angels got convinced that Adam was special? Why Muslims cannot, why can't we use what Adam used? Knowledge. Please always remember, in the Salafi cult, and I call it a cult, when any hadith, and I mean any hadith narrative, that is collected by Bukhari and Muslim at the same time, to a Salafi sheikh, scholar, think like that, that hadith narrative is considered to be at the same level of the Quran, and sometimes it even can supersede the Quran. In other words, a statement made by the messenger can abrogate, can nullify the meaning of an ayah, which also means that a hadith narrative can abrogate and negate the meaning of the Torah and the Injil, which also means can negate and abrogate the meaning of any other book that Allah has revealed, since the Quran is the last book in the chain of the books that Allah has revealed. This is a dangerous statement, absolutely dangerous, and this has given the right to the scholars to do as they please with Allah's religion. This is why there is a scholar, his name is Al-Qurtubi. He is one of the Salafi cult prominent scholar. This man was born and lived in Spain, in Andalusia, back in time when the Muslims had conquered Spain. He died in the year 1273 in the Christian era, almost 800 years ago. He said, a great scholar, the sheikhs speak about this man, Al-Qurtubi, and they say about him that he is a great scholar of jurisprudence, of fiqh, of the, you know, in the halal and the haram. He is a great scholar of hadith. And he is the author of the most, of one of the most relied upon books of tafsir. And it's called Tafsir Al-Qurtubi, the tafsir, the meaning of the Quran of Al-Qurtubi. Al-Qurtubi single-handedly voiced out the most evil theory in Islam. And as soon as he said it and wrote it down, it became something that each and every Salafi scholar not only believes in it, but acts upon it unashamedly, without any shame. Al-Qurtubi had pushed and advocated the idea that a hadith, when one hadith is authentic, it can abrogate the Quran. It can make the meanings of the Quran mean absolutely not a thing. In other words, for this Qurtubi and the Salafi cult and everybody else, a hadith that is sahih, authenticated, can invalidate and negate what Allah says in the Quran. Yeah, it's scary. Because as far as Salafi cult is concerned, if an authentic hadith says go left and the Quran says go right, the Salafi will go left. They have done this for the past 14 centuries and 43 years, as if where we are today in November 2021. Here is what Al-Qurtubi said, and every sheikh out there knows this. He says, وَحُذَّاقُ الْأَئِمَّةِ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ الْقُرْآنَ يُنْسَخُ بِالسُّنَّةِ. I'll translate this. And the cleverest imams, sheikhs, scholars, and everybody, are of the opinion that the Quran can be abrogated by the Sunnah. Yes, yes, the Quran can lose its meaning to the Sunnah. In other words, the Quran says something, the Sunnah says something else. Guess what? The Sunnah wins. That's why Muslims today read the Quran in Ramadan, in Taraweeh, and all that nonsense. And guess what? There is no change in their lives. Because as soon as Ramadan goes away, the Hadith comes in force and becomes like a driving force of this Islam. And this is why there is a fierce and bloody resistance from the different men of religions. The moment you say, I only accept the Quran, they straight away turn into violent savages. And if they could, they will kill you in less than a minute. I have lived that. I've been threatened. I've been of being beaten, and God knows it. And I am sure if I were in an Arab Muslim country, I would have been jailed or killed by now. Why? Because for pushing the Quran forward. I didn't say bring the Bible, the Torah, bring John Lennon. No, I said the Quran. You see, the sheikhs and the scholars do not tell the general public about this satanic theory that the Hadith can abrogate the Quran. They cannot come and tell it to you face to face, because you're going to go, what? But they will act on it. They will do what this means. And that's why hardly ever you find a whole talk made around the Quran only. It always is Qala Rasulullah, the Messenger of Allah said, the Messenger, while they know 100% that he didn't say it. It's only a possibility of the meaning, not the wordings. But they still fight to you. Qala Rasulullah, the Messenger of Allah said, the Messenger of Allah said. My dear sisters and my brothers, what is the position of this Hadith narrative in Islam? The halal is clear, the haram is clear, that's what I'm talking about. You see, as we know it, Islam is Allah's religion. It is His and His alone. Allah made sure for us humans to know this absolute truth, that the only one who has a say what goes inside Islam is Allah. That's why He chooses the prophets, the messengers, and He sends them with clear instructions to humans, and Allah reveals through them to the humans. You see, the Quran is a truth and it is mentioned in all books. Yet, when it comes to the active actions, they go against that. After all, hasn't Allah said, Inna deena indallahi al-Islam? Certainly the religion with Allah is Islam. In other words, what Allah is clearly stating and saying, that the only style of living that He accepts from human is to submit to Him, to submit to the laws He issues, to listen to Him, understand what He wants from you, act on His commands, ask for forgiveness and pardon when you make mistakes. This is the religion for Allah. So how did a religion that belongs to Allah and Allah alone becomes a religion that becomes suddenly to Muhammad, to the man of cloth, to the man of religion, to the rabbis, to the priests, to the popes, to the sheikh, to the scholar? How did that happen? And here, we're going to go all the way to the back of how it all began. You see, when Shaitan refused to obey Allah at the time of Adam's ceremony, as Shaitan declared his hate and animosity to the humankind and promised Allah that he would do his best to take a huge chunk of those humans with him to hellfire. Well, Allah made him a promise at that time. And He told him, as Allah says in the Quran, قُلْنَا هَبِطُوا مِنْهَا جَمِيعًا. And we said, all of you together, get out of it. Get out of the place where Allah had put Adam and the Jannah, but it was not in heaven, it was on earth. And Shaitan, get out of there. And then Allah carries on, فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي هُدَى. Then, should ever a guidance come to you from me? فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَيْ. So whoever follows my guidance, فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَهُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. There shall be no fear upon them, nor shall they grieve. Please notice how Allah emphasizes on guidance from me and my guidance. فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي هُدَى. There should ever be a guidance that comes from me. So whoever follows my guidance. not the guidance of Allah and Jesus, not the guidance of Allah and Moses, not the guidance of Allah and Abraham, not the guidance of Allah and Muhammad, not the guidance of Allah of anyone. No, Allah knows only guidance from me and my guidance. That's it. Guidance is from Allah. And when it is in the hands of humans, it remains Allah's property. The Quran was never the property of Muhammad, just like the Torah was never the property of Moses, just like the Gospel was never the property of Jesus. They all still are the property of Allah. So Moses or Jesus or Muhammad or any other messengers that Allah has sent before that, it doesn't give them any right or any powers to inject anything into Allah's religion. All what the messengers have to do is to act on what Allah tells them. And that's why Allah has made it clear in the Quran that the job descriptions of the messengers, a whole of them, is one, is to bring good news to people for those who believe and obey, and warn those who do not believe. That's all. That is all. So when people ask, okay, so we have two choices. I can either obey and listen and believe and listen, or disobey. What should I be believing and not believing? They go, oh, here is what Allah says. And then Allah brings in the revelation. Look at what Allah says in the Quran. وَمَا نُرْسِلُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ إِلَّا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنْذِرِينَ. And we do not send envoys or messengers except as bearers of good news or as warners. That's it. And this is in Surah Al-Kahf, Surah number 18, Ayah 56. This surah that Muslims read every Friday. But Allah says it, that He doesn't send messengers for any other reason except for two things. Bring good news and warn. And just in case someone says, oh, this is for other messengers, but Muhammad is different from them. He is the top of them. He is the best of them. All this is nonsense. Muhammad is just a human being, a messenger like any other one. Allah speaks to him directly, to Muhammad, and he tells him, "Inna arsalnaka bil haqqi bashiran wa nadhiran." We surely have sent you with the truth, i.e. with the Quran, as a deliverer of good news and as a warner, a direct message to Muhammad. No way of having any other thing. So, and this is in Surah Al-Baqarah, that's Surah number 2, Ayah 119. Then he repeats, Allah repeats the same thing in Surah Fatir, the Surah number 35, Ayah 24. Allah says, "Inna arsalnaka bil haqqi bashiran wa nadhiran." The same thing. We surely have sent you with the truth, i.e. the Quran, as a deliverer of good news and as a warner. Same statement is repeated again by meaning in few other ayat in the Quran. These two ayats alone should have been enough to anyone who trusts the Quran that the sole missions of Allah's messengers is to bring good news to people and warn them against rejecting what Allah has sent down to them. It never was for any of them to say this is halal and that is haram. But what is incredible in all this is that the sheikhs and scholars told this ayah to take a hike, and they allow themselves to mess Allah's religion. They read the ayah. When you ask them, they tell you, oh, it means this. Yet to them, it just stays like that, a word they say. When it comes to the practice, they become an absolute authority. In another ayah, Allah directly again addresses Muhammad and warns him of the following. Ya ayyuhar rasul, O you messenger, and Allah is talking directly to Muhammad here, O you messenger, بلغ ما أنزل إليك من ربك, relay everything descended to you from your Lord, i.e. tell it to people, tell everything that Allah has revealed to you from your Lord. وإن لم تفعل, and if you do not, should you ever withhold a little from what Allah has revealed, then you have not delivered His message. And this in Surah Al-Ma'idah, the Surah number 5, Ayah 67. And this Surah Al-Ma'idah was revealed 12 weeks before the death of the messenger. Why did Allah reveal this? Well, it's simple really. Because Allah had revealed something to the messenger and the messenger was reluctant at telling it to people. So Allah threatens him. If you don't say that, you have not delivered Allah's message as a whole. And this tells us that the messenger of Allah, when he received the revelation, he had some degree of freedom to say or not to say. And this makes the Islam beautiful, beautiful. So Allah warns him, deliver, relate to people everything that Allah has descended upon you. And if you do not do that, then you have not delivered the entire message. Why? Because the job description of Muhammad is really clear, as is any other messenger, that you are sent to deliver the message, not to legislate with start halal and haram. Here is the job description, well put by Allah. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرِ And we have descended upon you a dhikr, i.e. the Qur'an. For what reason? The reason it really is simple. لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ So that you broadcast to people what has been descended to them. Because you see, Allah can talk to us. We can all hear a voice coming from the heaven, and that's it. But Allah didn't want to do that. Allah used a human being to talk to us as humans. So it's easy for us to relate to that. So the job of Muhammad was to broadcast to people what has been descended to them. وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ And when you tell them what you have told them, and their task is to reflect on it, on the Quran. This is in Surah An-Nahl, Surah 16, the Ayah 44. You see, the messenger Muhammad, it's like, or any other messenger, they are just like the telephone lines. They just transmit the message, but have no control over what gets transmitted through them. Allah talks to the Arabs through one channel, through Muhammad. Allah talks to the children of Israel through one channel, from Moses and then the other messengers. Allah talks to the people of Abraham through Abraham. You see, the majority of the commentators and the translators of the meaning, everybody, they play with this word and they changed its meaning. They say, لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ So that the real meaning is that, so that you broadcast to people what has been sent to them. And they changed it to, so that you may explain to people what has been revealed to them. So that you may clarify to people what has been revealed to them. Not broadcast. So now the job of the messenger is not only to speak the Quran, but to explain the meaning of the Quran. Then the question comes in, if the job of the messenger was to explain to people, then who should we listen to? Because we do not have the original text of what the messenger explained the Quran with. We don't have that in the book. If Muhammad's job was to explain to people, then why didn't he hold weekly circles, daily circles, sit in a masjid, and people have a circle around him, and he explained the Quran? Why didn't he do that? Why? Because it was not his job. It was, if the messenger of Allah had sat in a mosque and held a circle or a seminar or whatever he did to explain to people the Quran would only stay in that era, is not for us for until the end of time. Why Allah didn't want the Quran to be explained? Because Allah wanted the Quran to remain fluid, to fly with time, to fly with humanity. And that is the purpose why Muhammad is not someone to explain or clarify the Quran. Because elsewhere in the Quran, Allah has stated that the job of explaining the Quran and the task of clarifying the Quran is by Allah himself. And he didn't give it to any other human. I will stop here and carry on to part 3. We get into the 50 minutes mark. And on the upcoming one, inshallah, we will go on and deal with more of this dangerous and shaitanic and devilish narrative. Again, this is your real brother Abdus Salam, and off to part 3. Assalamu alaikum.